talking about the spirit of prophecy or the prophetic anointing. And I have, I've wrestled with this a little bit. I've joked with people, hang with me. I've often said that I live a double life. That's why I said, hang with me. And so here in Lakeland, many of you know me as an elder or a pastor, but many people around the nation recognize me as an established prophetic voice to the nation. And so many times here in Lakeland, we're working on shepherding people and trying to help you in a very practical way. And I'm off on the road all over the nation, teaching on the prophetic, starting revival fire, all sorts of different things. And so I'm learning how to navigate the call that the Lord has placed on my life. And I have, I've grieved a little bit in my spirit personally, out of a heart that wants to see our community here in Lakeland grow more prophetically. I feel like I have given a lot of time on the road and around the nation, really laying a prophetic foundation in many churches and maybe neglecting to lay a strong prophetic foundation in this house. And so I apologized a few weeks ago, and I'm going to apologize again. The Lord, I believe, is, and again, whether you need to be apologized to or not, or whether you feel offended or not, it just clears my conscience with the Lord and what He puts me up to, just to repent before you and just say that I'm going to be faithful to be who God has called me to be. And I believe in this house that looks like raising up a prophetic company who has eyes to see and ears to hear what the Spirit is saying in this hour. So I don't have to try. It's just who I am. So I'm going to teach on prophecy. I'm going to prophesy over many of you this morning as the Spirit of God leads. So are you ready? I think one of the things that is so important as we're walking with one another, not just me, but with one another, is that we're learning how to honor the gifts of the Spirit that God has placed on one another. Because when we stop honoring what God has put on someone, we stop receiving from them. Hello. What I love about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and even the gifts that the Lord has given me, the Lord has given me the gift of prophecy since I was a young boy. Now, what I know is that that can mean anything, and literally anything can happen. I get excited about that because I believe I can so yield to the Spirit of God, I literally don't even know what's about to happen. And I get excited about other people who believe that too. Because if I know that someone has a gift on their life, let's say healing. But this is Jesus the carpenter from Nazareth. See, they didn't receive him because they failed to recognize who he was. Do you know one another according to the flesh? Or do you know one another according to the Spirit? I'm talking about marriage too. Do you know your spouse according to the flesh? Or do you know who they are according to the Spirit? And can you honor what God has put on them so that you can actually receive from them? Okay, now I'm trying to help us. I believe a lot of people have no idea how to receive. Yeah, but they're this way and they raise their kids that way and blah, blah, blah. I believe all of those are obstacles and hindrances that tangle us up in the flesh that hinder us from receiving the gifts that God has put on somebody's life. I have been rebuked about this time and time again. Preachers, I didn't like their style, I didn't like their, and I would sit in their meetings and not receive at all. Why? Because I had a critical heart. I had negativity, something in me prevented me, and the Lord would deal so decisively. You're knowing them according to the flesh, You've not yet learned how to know them according to the Spirit, and when you repent and get over your stuff, I'll open you up to another realm. And as that's happened time and time again, I would go to the same person's meeting and have one of the most tremendous encounters that I've ever had, and it had nothing to do with them, it had to do with me. We haven't even prayed yet. Just close your eyes for a second. Father, I ask for grace this morning to know one another according to the Spirit and not just to the flesh. Lord, I ask that we begin to highlight the gifts and the calling and the grace that you've put on each and every one of us. Father, we repent right now. Let's just go ahead and get it out there. Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would forgive us if there's any bitterness, any unforgiveness, any offense that we have with our spouse, with preachers, with family members that are actually hindering us from receiving what you're trying to communicate to us. Could it be that you're already speaking and we're deaf? Could it be that you're already trying to show us something and we're blind? Give us grace, Lord. We desperately need your grace to get over stumbling blocks. We want to honor you, Father. We want to honor one another. Lord, I pray that the gifts and the calling and the grace on each and every life in this church would become awakened. You sense the Spirit is even saying right now, some of you are learning how to honor what I've put on others, but you need to start honoring what I've put on you. So Lord, I pray for all those who have not yet received and fully stepped into the call that you have on their life. I thank you that there are intercessors in this room right now that have not yet learned how to pray. And we call you out of hiding. Right now there's just a shift in the atmosphere. Some of you just felt something in your belly. We prophesy a yielding, we'll yield to the Spirit. Lord, we call forth the missionaries in this room, those that are called to the nations but are fearful. Lord, we awaken them right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, we call forth our entrepreneurs. We call forth those that are working for somebody else that should start working for themselves. Lord, we call them out of hiding right now in the name of Jesus. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Just encourage you, just begin to talk with Holy Spirit. Just ask him, what's the call on my life? Do I know the call in other people's lives? Do I know how to receive from you? Do I know how to receive from someone else? Who cares how old they are? Just break that spirit of religion off. Who cares what degree they have? Who cares where they come from? God can speak through a donkey. Surely he can speak through someone. Come on, Lord, I just break the prejudice. Lord, I thank you that you're using our children to speak through us. I just hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, if you will open up your spirit man to my voice, I'll reveal myself everywhere and in everybody. You can't miss me. Here's what I've become convinced of. We cannot get, now I'm talking to the house here, or the Father, we cannot get to where God wants to take us unless everyone in this room begins to step into what God has called you to do. I feel a massive stalemate over this church. So someone who, I work here full time, I sit in this office, I stay up late, I pour out my heart before the Lord, prayers, we work as a staff. But I'm telling you, when I get in the Spirit over this church and I begin to pray, I believe we're in a massive stalemate. And I believe that God will not move us forward unless we begin to get activated in what He's called us to and we learn how to do it as a family. Amen. How many of you know in today's society what I just said is not popular? As we've created atmospheres in the church where people like to sit. Or how about those some people, they like to actually do things, but they're inaccessible. The problem is just not people just sitting and hanging out. The problem is people in leadership and people actually doing things, they're inaccessible to people. They're performers. They're not family members.
That'll break.
Don't feel that spirit of condemnation. That's not from the Lord. Let the Holy Spirit bring conviction and liberate you. Because here's the deal. You will feel and live more freely as you step into what God has called you to do. There are people here that have been tending 2, 3, 4 years that I believe have still not stepped into what the Lord has placed upon their life. Now, I'm coming from it from a kingdom perspective. I don't need you to work for me. I don't need you to give your money to me. We want to empower you to step into the call on your life and walk in the freedom and the liberty that the Spirit has given you. I think a large part of the church, we're learning how to disconnect from the feeding tube that's attached to the pulpits in America. That's what we've got from the seeker-friendly model of church. You come in, you sit down, you plug into what's here, and you give tithes and offerings so that the man of God or woman of God can tell you what God is saying. So we can just watch them operate in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and we walk out as mere babes and infants. Never knew that becoming just a believer in Jesus Christ brought with it so much responsibility. All right, how we doing? If you have the call of God on your life, would you please stand? Because if everyone in here is not standing, you're living in deception. Every person in this room has the call of God on your life. I'm talking a 2-year-old and a 99-year-old. Every person has the grace of God on your life. Every person in this room, there is room for you in God's kingdom. Let's stop fighting over territory and who can do this or that best. And let's start learning how to work together to advance the kingdom of God in this city and in this nation. But we've got to begin to ask Holy Spirit, how can I get involved? And again, unfortunately, this right here has become the greatest idol. Give me the mic. I'll finally fulfill my call if I can stand on a stage. And I believe the Lord is doing away. I believe that paradigm of church will become more and more irrelevant in the days ahead. And I believe what the Lord is about to put display in America is an army. It's people that have stepped into their divine design. They recognize the call on their life and they step into it. You can be seated. Well, I feel unction from the Holy Spirit to say this. It's one thing to know your call, and then it's another thing to step into it. And the thing is, most of us are the only ones that know truly whether we've stepped into it or not. Anybody else good at faking other people out? Okay, just me. Never stepping into the fullness of the calling, and I just get excited. I get excited that the Lord is not going to bring a third great awakening to America because the preachers get more anointed.
Right.
We're going to have revival and awakening in this nation when teachers begin to spend time in the secret place and make God known in the public place. This is why I feel like we're so behind in the American church right now. We really don't believe this. We really don't believe that preachers and prophets don't have some special access to God that we don't. Do you know you have the same access to God to the most anointed people you know? I said, religion tells you to shut up, but in revival, God says to speak up. And as the Lord awakens the gifting and the calling and the grace of God on our lives, it's going to require a lot of us to stop being insecure, to stop being jealous, and stop being prideful of what we're carrying. And learn that every joint supplies. We need one another. No one is carrying the fullness of some revelation. And when we begin to recognize that we need one another, we'll migrate to one another. When we begin to recognize that we need one another, I'll give it to you. Because we recognize that God has put something on someone else that we don't have that can help us. What a blow to our pride. I'm struggling to raise my kids, and my wife and I are fighting or whatever, and oh, wait a minute, there's someone at Heart of the Father that's been married like 40 years and has raised kids successfully, and what if they have what I need? And the only thing keeping me from destiny and breakthrough is me swallowing my pride. Honor. We've got to learn how to honor one another. We've got to learn how to ask for help. We've got to learn how to bear one another's burdens. Let's turn to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15. Now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of those without strength and not just please ourselves. It's amazing in the Bible how much just one verse blows up our current model of church. I mean, I can't come to church for me anymore? You mean it's not about me? You mean being part of a community of believers is about bearing somebody else's weakness? Not coming to church and trying to get my own needs met? Yes, that sounds like family and not an organization. Verse 2, let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. Are we seeking to please those of us? Are we seeking to please people around us for their edification? For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell upon me. For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, that through perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement grant you to be of the same mind with one another, according to Christ Jesus, that with one accord you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord wants to teach us how to bear one another's burdens. Would you agree? How can we know someone else's burdens if all they are is a person in front of us that we see one time a week? How can you possibly bear somebody else's burdens if you don't know what they're going through? Now, it really goes two ways. How can someone know your need if you don't let it be known? A lot of people struggling, no one knows because they won't say anything. On the flip side, how can we do our part to get to know people and through relationship find out what they're going through? This is what I believe. To the degree that we'll learn how to love one another, to that degree, the Spirit of God will move in our midst. This is the word that the Lord gave me. And I believe it's prophetic for this house. I told you I feel like we're in a stalemate. Here's the stalemate. Unless we learn how to love one another, bear one another's burdens, God will not pour out his Spirit here like we're so desiring. I just like the services, not New Testament. It's funny how we're living under a new covenant with so many old covenant mindsets. You were born for intimacy. You were born for eternal glory with the Father. But you were born to be in communion and relationship with one another. We can't be who we're not at this church. I do not believe, as we go ahead and we move ahead, that if people are not committed to relationship and community and transparency, that they'll lock in with this body. I believe they'll begin to fall off one by one. And I feel like the Lord has been saying to me, you've got to stick to your DNA at Heart of the Father. You've got to be who you are. You cannot meet every need that walks in the door. A burden-bearing community. That even in our services, what would take place, basically what happened this morning, that we would actually take time to pray for one another. And I pray that we wouldn't just pray for 5 minutes this morning, but that we would pray for that person throughout the week. Maybe we'd care enough to get their phone number. That so should not be unusual. Really believe in the church, the Lord is trying to take what we think is abnormal and make it normal. Miracles should not be abnormal. They should be the norm. Community and transparent relationship. We should not have people showing up to churches saying, "Oh my gosh, I finally met the pastor. Oh my gosh, I finally got a meal with someone in the church." That's not what Jesus died for. That's not what we find in the book of Acts. How we doing? All right, let's close our eyes just for a second. We're just going to keep pausing. Father, we thank you that all deep relationships require trust and vulnerability. We pray right now over all those who have been wounded and offended by the church. We speak to these walls that are hindering us from letting our guard down. Hear the Lord saying, the issue is not with them, your issue is with me. Stop knocking on their door and come knock on my door. I'm home. Holy Spirit, we welcome here. Only He can extract the pain and the offense. Only He can take the knives out of your back. You cannot continue in the cycle of offense. You cannot continue in the years and years of excuses of why you can't. We thank you that there's healing that's available here this morning. Even just want to go up one step higher. Lord, we remove the knife in the city of Lakeland's back. I've met more people in this city that have been hurt by the church than any city I've ever been to. So Lord, we choose to walk in forgiveness. Hearing people say, "I've been hurt by the church." I want to hear people say, "I've been loved by the church. I've been cherished. They bore my burdens. They were there when my marriage was on the rocks. They were there when I had no idea what to do with my kids. They were there when I didn't have any money to pay my bills. They were there." Give us grace. Give us grace to change the tune. Saying insecure fathers produce performance-oriented sons. Some of you were raised by insecure fathers, and you're still trying to perform and earn God's love. So, Father, we sit down and we rest from all our striving. And we receive the love of a father. One, again, I want to say it. Some of you have to literally step into this. It's not about hearing it. You've got to step into the new identity, the word the Lord has for you. And I want to talk a little bit about prophecy. I believe that prophecy begins with loving people enough to ask God questions about them. Moving in a prophetic spirit begins with loving the people around us enough to ask God questions about them. But I've got to tie this back to, if we don't love people for real, we're not going to ask God questions about them. If we don't know anything about their life, if we don't know what they're going through, if we don't know what we should be praying with them about, how are we going to move in a prophetic spirit toward them? More time. Prophecy begins with loving people enough to ask God questions about them. You know that who probably will go out to eat after service today? Do you know God in a moment can fill your heart with love for your waiter or waitress enough for you to ask God a question about them? How are they doing? Imagine that. What do you have for them in the future? Is there anything I can be praying for them about? God can fill your love in a moment for them, and just by being encouraging and bearing a burden, bam, the power of God falls. Let's pray again. Just bow your heads. Father, we ask that Romans 5:5, that you would pour out your love into our hearts by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, again, we remove offense. We remove bitterness, accusation, suspicion, judgment. Get it out of us right now. Extract it. No more poison. No more poison, no more pollution. Remove it right now and fill our hearts with love for those around us. Lord, let there be an outpouring of love in our community. Prophecy comes when we have a burden to encourage and bless the people around us. There is no magic formula to prophesying. It all depends on our love for God. When we love Him fully, that love should spill over to the people all around us. Prophecy is simply encouraging, exhorting, and comforting people in the world. There are people who need the life-giving word from God. These aren't just the individuals who are obviously struggling. Some appear to have it all together, but God knows what's really going on. Everyone could benefit from a prophetic word, even those for whom everything is soaring. I love to prophesy over people who are doing really well. If we can target those people and increase their faith at a critical time, they can fly even higher and soar even higher in the Spirit. I'm the kind of guy, I not only give to the poor, but I also bless the rich. Ever thought about sowing seed into something God is actually blessing? I believe strongly. Lord, get that mindset out of us. We just don't bless the poor. We bless those that have more than us. I don't find the poorest looking person in the restaurant to anonymously buy their meal. I find the people who have gold and everything else. I find the people who ate the steak, not ordered the appetizer. Because I want to have a hand in what God is blessing. Right. I believe strongly that the more encouraging, exhorting, and comforting prophecy we have, the better our churches will be. This is so my heart for this community. If we could have a family of believers that was addicted to comforting, encouraging, and strengthening one another, we would soar so high in this city. You know, it's really hard to encourage others when you don't feel good about yourself. It's really hard to encourage others when you show up to church for yourself. Who feels that tension in the room? But we're being stretched because new wine is coming. I'm telling you, there's new wine that the Lord is going to pour out in this community. And I'm telling you, old wineskins will not last. The old wineskin of a performing church where we just get in and get out and come back will not last for what God is about to do in this city. God is going to pour out His Spirit in a community of believers who call one another family. We want the power in the book of Acts, but we don't want the family in the book of Acts. Well, brother, I've been in some revivals and seen the power of God move. Well, why did it end? Because they didn't have family. Why are you hurt from the last move of God? Because we didn't know how to do family. Encouraging. Just look at me. Mad. Does anybody like to encourage people? I mean, has anybody ever benefited from the power of encouragement? I mean, we all have bad days. We all go through seasons. But the church is supposed to be a place where people can get encouragement, they can get comfort, and they can get strength. It's a place where people should come and be empowered and fueled up, and not ready to, hear me, not ready to come back next Sunday, but ready to take their workplace by force. Come on, I reveal to you the new wine. The old wineskin of churches, I'll come and do my thing on Sunday and I'll come back next Sunday. I believe old wineskin is I'm living for the weekends. Well, where's the kingdom of God during the week? This is the primary way I've seen salvation. Sit in a restaurant, happened a couple weeks ago. Just start to get to know the waitress. Just love on her. I'm not even asking God for a word. Just love on her. How are you doing? How many kids do you have? What's your name? Do you live in the city? Build some relationship. Then God begins to speak. First of all, she can't pay her bills. So rather than your little $5 tip, I want you to give her a $200 tip. Oh my gosh, could that be God? Yeah. I don't know a time when God's ever told me to give money when I had it. I bless everybody that lives that way, but I don't know anything about that. Give him $5,000. Well, I only have $6,000. Give it to him. Find out how they're doing. The word of the Lord breaks in. We start praying for this waitress. She's literally manifesting demons in a restaurant. We begin to bind those, tell them to shut their mouth. She literally gives her life to the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord breaks out in the restaurant. We begin to lay hands on the cooks. The owner came out. And it was literally just over little relationship, a little love. And again, I don't know why we find this so hard. Little love. This is what it means to be a Christ follower. His love should be so tangible and so overpowering that we can't help but not share it. It really is good news. It's more than a Band-Aid. It's more than a shot in the arm on Sunday and Wednesdays. It's the gospel of the good news that people need to hear about a God who came and died on the cross for their sins and is just not a ticket into heaven, but they can walk in the fullness of power and presence while they yet live. Like I tell people, I'm just not offering you joy in the afterlife. How about joy in the presence of God forevermore? But how are they going to encounter God if we're not living from the place of encounter?
Right.
A lot of places, the church has become so boring and so robotic, no wonder they won't come to church. They don't get born again, they get born into a church. How we do? Want to dance on it? Encouragement, comfort, strength, smile. There's fullness of joy in the presence of God. We should leave meetings on Sunday so full of joy and fresh perspective. Ready to go out and take the kingdom by force. When we get low, call somebody. Here's an honest question. When's the last time you called a brother or sister in this community because you were having a bad day at work and said, I need you to hold me up in prayer right now? Oh, we'd just rather do it on our own. Comes with you wine. You don't have to do it.
Brother,
just drink the wine. Turn to 1 Corinthians 14. Problem when I talk about prophecies, I can literally talk about it 52 Sundays in a row. Harry went to like, what, 1240 last week, so I'm good. I'm just commenting on his message last week. Did you guys think that was an awesome message? I love. All right, here it is. 1 Corinthians 14. That's those first two words.
Love.
Pursue love. This is where all prophecy begins. No, and let me just say something. No matter how hard the word is, we better remember who we're talking to. Because there's a king and a bridegroom, and you're his bride. And I think he would care about how his wife was talked to. Pursue love. Pray this every day. I don't know. The Lord has awakened me to my bankruptcy of love. That sounds unspiritual. Have you ever recognized how unloving of a person you are without God? I don't need to fast to get that revelation. Lord, I need your love. I feel like sometimes he kind of laughs with us when we come to him and say, I can't stand this person. He's like, well, yeah. You can, but ask me for my love. I dream of the Father and his family. And having hundreds, maybe thousands of people who are in tight-knit love relationship with others. Where I have kids and they have 100 aunts and aunts in this room. Cliff, can I just exhort you for a second? Our healing night service, Lisa had come, the babies. One of them was in a stroller, and the Lord said to me, watch Cliff. I watched Cliff, and he just came over like a father, and he played with one of the kids and just loved on him. And the Lord said, that's what I want here. Yes, some came and ministered healing and prayed, but there were also some fathers who migrated over to help a mom whose husband wasn't here because he was away working and said, hey, let me just be a tangible father here in this moment. That's the kingdom of God if I've ever seen it. I feel him. He's here. Pursue love, yet desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Pointed this out before, I just want to point out again. Paul the Apostle gave us permission to pursue, the Greek says, to zealously lust after spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. You know, it can be a convicting question, but how many of you are burning with lust to move in spiritual gifts? Lord, fill us up with love. I would say of all the things young people are lusting after. Lusting after one another, lusting after the deeds of the flesh. What if we begin to lust after spiritual gifts? I'm going to get lit up this morning. Not only dreaming of a community who's so full of love. I mean, they're like tanks of love. Their cup is overflowing. Yeah. But these people are zealous to be used in the kingdom of God, that wherever there's a need is. Here's what, again, I love about Holy Spirit. It has nothing to do with us. Yeah. I believe if you yield to the Holy Spirit fully, He'll use you in any way, in any circumstance that He sees fit. When I yielded, oh, I don't have healing, or I've never seen anybody healed. Lord, I believe you by faith that you says, they that believe, signs and wonders will follow them. So I'm yielding to your Holy Spirit in this moment. And I love this person. He's a brother. He's a father. And in the name of Jesus, I commend you to be healed.
Yeah, that's right.
So Lord, let love be our portion. But would you awaken the spiritual gifts in this community? What if we were so yielded to the Spirit we could drive out all sickness and disease from this place? It puts the fear of the Lord in me that there could be someone in here with a legitimate healing gift, that by you choosing to remain silent, somebody is afflicted with something. It puts the fear of the Lord in me to know that a marriage could literally be headed for divorce in this room, and you have the word of encouragement for them that's going to see them through, that's going to spare their children from heartache and pain the next 20 years. This is sobering stuff. But I'm beginning to recognize the power and the soberness that comes with being a new covenant believer. It's amazing. It's an opportunity. It's a blessing to say, Lord, I'm ready to get involved. This is the cry of Isaiah. Here I am. Send me. Samuel, here I am. I just believe the Lord's looking for willing hearts. He's looking for a company, a family of believers that will walk in the spirit of prophecy. Look at verse 3. But one who prophesies speaks to men for edification, exhortation, and consolation. So the purpose behind prophecy, and I'm going to just get into these three words and I'll begin to land the plane. What is prophecy for? We've talked about loving people. We've talked about God using us to encourage and comfort and strengthen people, but I want to break down these Greek words for you. So prophecy number one is for edification, if you're taking notes. The Greek word here is oikodomen. In essence, it's the act of building up. So Paul says to zealously lust after spiritual gifts, but of all the spiritual gifts, what's the one that God wants us to pursue the most? Okay, five of you. What's the one gift of the Holy Spirit that God wants us to pursue more than any other gift?
Prophecy.
Not because he knew how destructive it could be. Everywhere that I travel, I have to repent to people for why the gift of prophecy has been so destructive in their midst. Paul didn't say above all else pursue prophecy because of what he knew the damage it, but because he knew the power of when we begin to build one another up in love. I imagine people throughout the week, they get torn down. They get discouraged. They can't pay their bills. Somebody's sick. But when we come in as a family, we build back the deficit that they experienced during the week. So when we gather together, we can pray and say, Lord, give me encouragement, give me edification so that I can build up my brother and sister in the Lord rather than tear them down. It's amazing how self-conscious people are. Low self-esteem. Don't think they can do it. It's amazing how many young people, this is what I get excited. You're under 30, stand up. If you're under 30. Okay, just keep standing. I'm gonna say this in love. Moms and dads, where are you? Moms and dads, where are you? I can't imagine what a word of encouragement and comfort and strength would do in a young person's life on their journey to know God. Surely there's something that has happened in your life, whether good or bad, that could be used as a word of wisdom to some young person standing. All right, let's close our eyes. Stay standing. Let's close our eyes. Everybody. Father, I ask that you would fill our hearts with love, even for the young people that you keep sending the heart of the Father. How long will we allow them to walk in and out without reaching out? When will a mom and dad maybe have some of these young people over their house for lunch when we know half of them don't have a job, which is okay? College students here this morning who don't even have money for lunch, what would just a small act of love do to change their life? Holy Spirit, we welcome you here not to condemn, but to bring encouragement and strength and comfort. I'll give you a prophecy right now. The Lord is telling me, as we learn how to take care of these, I'll multiply them. I'll fill this gymnasium up. To the degree you love them, to that degree I'll multiply them. Maybe the issue here is not trying to grow the church. Maybe it's stewardship. Father, let the generations mingle. Let there be a Malachi 4, 5, and 6. Sons and fathers, daughters and mothers. Let there be a convergence. Let there be a cohesion. In the name of Jesus, you can be seated. Does anybody else feel like, I feel the weight of destiny in this room. God has helped me so much with my problems when I help somebody else with theirs. God has helped me with my depression as I spoke freedom over somebody else's. Mom, what if the breakthrough to your marriage would come if you ministered to somebody else's? Can I just be real honest? I've stood on platforms in front of thousands of people and prophesied the word of the Lord and was not confident that God even loved me in those moments. You do not have to have it all together. By the way, this is how they disciple in foreign nations. If you know something that someone else doesn't, share. All right, Holy Spirit, help us to get this. Help us to build one another up. Number two, exhortation. The Greek word is paraklesis. It means a calling near, a summoning, a persuasive discourse, a stirring address, a calling near. Come on, some of us moms and dads, we can move in a spirit of exhortation by gathering the young people to us, calling them near, summoning them, giving them a stirring. I know my dad has this gift. General Joe. Feel this so heavy for the fathers. And have you ever had just sons, they're busy, they're tired, they think that, you know, the end of the world is coming, they can't pay their bills, they're stressed out, and the father just comes along and says, you're going to make it. And gives them a charge, gives them a summon, gives them an exhortation, and they were looking down at their feet, but now they're looking forward. Vision of a massive altar call in here. Lord, release the gift of exhortation, that we would stir one another to love, that we would provoke one another to love and good deeds, that we would get the fire of God inside of us for someone that we know that is stuck, someone that we know that is sick, and we would say, in the name of Jesus, I'm not going to continue to come in and out of this church and watch you suffer and do nothing. Right. Not because I'm bound in religion, but because I love you. Yeah. I'm telling you, the supreme issue this morning, it's a love issue. We take care of those we love. We make time for those we love. We sacrifice for those that we love. And until we love one another, we fall more in love again. I believe that the Lord is, it's like there's a dam here. He's holding the water, and it's about to break forth if we'll yield and say yes. Yeah. Edification, exhortation, finally, consolation. Greek word paramuthis. It means a calming and a comforting. Lord, I want to have a calming effect. All right, I'm just going to go with this. I hear Holy Spirit talking to me. God wants you to be approachable. You to be approachable. He wants you to have a calming effect on the people that you're in love relationship with. People should not be afraid that you're going to fly off the handle. Your children should not be afraid that you're going to snap. There should be a calming. There should be a comforting effect. Who knows people like this? It's like every time I call them safe places. You're a safe place. People just come around you and they just let their hair done. They just come undone. That we would walk in a prophetic spirit of calming and comforting, that the brokenhearted, the bound of this city, could walk in these doors and have a safe place to cry. Where they wouldn't get condemnation on all this stuff, but they just get moms and dads, brothers and sisters that are willing to cry with them through their pain. Like I'm assembling my dream church. But this is God's dream. It can be done. It will be done. We are pioneering something in Lakeland that I believe is going to be a model for around the nation. You can prophesy, you can work miracles, you can speak to mountains, but if you don't have love, we're nothing. You can have the greatest church services, the best preachers, the best worship team, the best Easter outreaches. But if we don't have love, if we don't have strong marriages, if we don't have healthy families, if we don't have people doing love relationship with one another, we cannot get to where God's called us. Let's close our eyes. Father, I sense there's so much at stake here. What we're fighting for in this community has the capability of impacting this city for years to come. People in the city who have been burned by the church, hurt by the church, wounded by the church, and are just looking for a family. Father, I pray this morning that you'd let that be us, that you'd let this be a safe place. People could receive the truth spoken in love. God, I release in the name of Jesus the spirit of prophecy in this room. Lord, I pray a prophetic anointing over every marriage and every relationship in this room in the name of Jesus. We replace accusation and criticism and even narcissism. The Lord says to someone, you can't get the diagnosis, but here it is. I'm delivering you from narcissism in the name of Jesus. It is not about you, it's about her. Father, release encouragement all over the room. Release burden bearing all over the room. Lord, place people in this room on our hearts. Would you do that right now? Just say, Lord, place this family on my heart. That's all you have to do. Maybe it's just one person. Maybe it's 10 people. Maybe it's one family. Maybe it's one young person.